people all say, well, you have to, you know, you're flying, Suzuki, you're flying around in a plane, you're a hypocrite, or, you know, you've got a gas-guzzling sports utility vehicle, you're a hypocrite. Wait a minute now, we're in a period of transition. We know we can't go on living this way. But right now, the important thing is solidarity. So the people understand, what is it that is our highest priority? I said this to the CEO of an oil company in the tar sands of Alberta. I said, what do you think is the most important thing every human being needs? And any child would tell you in a minute. And he went, and I could see he's wondering, is it a job? Is it money? Is it a company? Like, I said, look, Mr. CEO, if you don't have air for 3 minutes, you're dead. If you have to breathe polluted air, you're sick. So surely, even though you own a big oil company, surely you would agree with me. Clean air has got to be the highest priority of any human being on the planet. And then you go through water and the soil, you know, those are things. Without them, we die. So how can you treat them the way we treat them, by putting toxic chemicals in them? So clean air, clean water, clean soil, those are the highest priorities. Then you ask, how can I make a living? But we're doing it the other way around. We say, the economy is everything. You got nothing, should destroy that. And pour more junk into the air, the water, the soil. We got it upside down.
Wow. So a message, any special message?
Well, for that's my message.
People out there.
My message to all Canadians is, thank the Indigenous people, they haven't been wiped out. Canadian policy since contact has been, get rid of those damn people, they're a pain in the ass, we want their land, so we'll do it by trying to make them into copies of us, or cultural genocide, wipe out their culture, their language, and thank God there are still people in Canada that understand their Indigenous roots. So the first thing all Canadians should do is thank them for hanging on to that, and then say, teach us, please. Teach us what you know and what you're fighting for about living with Mother Earth. We need that.
Absolutely. I'm so honored to have met you, Mr. Suzuki.
Thank you for having me.
You know, and just to let you know, our grandson nation is being a lot more closer to the earth now since I met you last.
No.
And I really thank you for that. And thank you so much. Is there anything else you would like to share?
No, it's your interview, not mine.
Yes. So with this, Dr. David Suzuki will be at the Waverly Library this evening. If you have any questions or...
Yeah, it's sold out though.
It is. I hope to see you there. And if not, it'll be recorded, live streamed, and you'll be able to obtain it. I'm so honored that you are here, blessing Thunder Bay again with your presence, and Chimikwich.
Thank you.
So with that, Nijwe Tmo, Kanishinaabe Nakas, Chimikwich. Haho. Bonjour, Nijwe Tmo, Kanishinaabe Nakas. We have Mr.
Our old friend.
Yes! Oh my goodness, it's been a while since I've seen you. Would you care to introduce yourself?
I'm David Suzuki, and I was a co-founder of the David Suzuki Foundation, but these days I say, I'm David Suzuki, I'm a grandfather and an elder.
Nice, nice. First-hand grandfather. I'm going to work on some grandfather laws in Canada.
Yes!
And grandparent laws.
Absolutely.
So welcome back to Thunder Bay.
Thank you.
So this time you have come on a mission.
Well, it's really to congratulate the people. Thunder Bay was one of the early supporters of the Blue Dot movement, and the city in fact has embraced the idea, which is great. The idea is that we want as many communities to adopt the idea of a right to a healthy environment. And if we get enough grassroots level support, then that will go to the premiers of the provinces. We need 7 provinces with more than 50% of the population of Canada. to support this idea, and then we can go to the federal government and say, we want a constitutional amendment. We think that every Canadian should expect to have a right to a healthy environment. Now you'd say, well, of course, who's against that? What is a healthy environment? Clean air, clean water, clean food from the soil, clean energy. There are a lot of people who would be threatened by that. You mean I can't dump my emissions or my toxic chemicals into air, water, and soil? You're damn right if we want a healthy environment. So I don't think it's going to be an easy sell. But one out of every three Canadians now lives in a jurisdiction. We have more than 140 communities that have signed on to the right to a healthy environment. That's more than one out of every three Canadians lives under that. So I think that we've got a good shot at this.
Nice, nice. So can you tell us a little bit more what exactly the Blue Dot movement is?
So the Blue Dot refers to our home, planet Earth. When you look at Earth from space, all you see is that beautiful, tiny thing. And you see no example that there's human beings on there. It's just this beautiful thing. And you think the layer that we live in, called the biosphere, is a thin, thin layer from space. It's like saran wrap around the planet. That's our home. And you think of all the wars and the battles and people trying to be big men or all that. It's nothing in that little tiny blue dot. And now we're saying, let's look at our home from space. We are now poisoning the very layer that we live in. And it's time to change things around. That's what the Blue Dot movement. Let's keep that thing blue and intact. And it's all basically, First Nations would call it Mother Earth. Mother Earth. That's not a romantic or a poetic way of speaking. This is what I have learned from First Nations. When you say Mother Earth, you mean it literally. And when you think about it, we are created out of the body of Mother Earth. The air, the water, the soil, the energy that's trapped by the sun. That's all what makes us possible. And that's given to us by Mother Earth. You would never treat your biological mother the way we're treating Mother Earth. And so I thank my First Nations teachers that have taught me this, not just in Canada, but around the world. Mm-hmm. Indigenous people around the world understand that. Mm-hmm. And this is a message that we're trying to spread, and it's not an accident that in every community we've been with the Blue Dot movement, it's been Indigenous people we've invited to join us. And they have gladly supported us because they're the ones that have taught us. Mm-hmm. We've got to now use the Blue Dot movement to relearn what Indigenous people know.
Sweet. So when you're traveling now with this Blue Dot movement, what is the message when you talk about the environmental bill?
Well, the message, a political one, is we have to get enough support to put pressure on our premiers and then on our federal government. But the message underlying why are we doing this is that we are so obsessed with the economy now that we had 9 years of a prime minister who said, we can't do anything about reducing emissions, it'll destroy the economy. So by saying that, he elevated the economy above the very air that we depend on. The economy was more important than the atmosphere. This is madness. So we're trying to get back to very simple things. We keep running out the economy. You can't change nature. We all depend on clean air, clean water, clean soil for our health and well-being. The economy is a human invention. You know, we act as if we've got to serve the economy. No. The economy was created to serve us. And now it's causing a lot of problems with Mother Earth. So we've got to change the economy. Instead, the politicians say, you got to sacrifice public social services because the economy's in bad shape. No. We're in bad shape. We need a different kind of economy. We've got to change it. That's part of the message. We've got to find out what are our priorities. How do we have to live on Earth? to be healthy and happy and well cared for.
So one of the first priorities is, what do you think, solidarity?
Well, of course. I mean, people all say, well, you have to, you know, you're flying around in a plane, you're a hypocrite, or, you know, you've got a gas-guzzling sports utility vehicle, you're a hypocrite. Wait a minute now, we're in a period of transition. We know we can't go on living this way. But right now, the important thing is solidarity. So the people understand, what is it that is our highest priority? I said this to the CEO of an oil company in the tar sands of Alberta. I said, what do you think is the most important thing every human being needs? And any child would tell you in a minute. And he went, and I could see he's wondering, is it a job? Is it money? Is it a company? Like, I said, look, Mr. CEO, if you don't have air for 3 minutes, you're dead. If you have to breathe polluted air, you're sick. So surely, even though you own a big oil company, surely you would agree with me. Clean air has got to be the highest priority of any human being on the planet. And then you go through water and the soil, you know, those are things. Without them, we die. So how can you treat them the way we treat them, by putting toxic chemicals in them? So clean air, clean water, clean soil, those are the highest priorities. Then you ask, how can I make a living? But we're doing it the other way around. We say, the economy is everything. You got nothing, should destroy that. And pour more junk into the air, the water, the soil. We got it upside down.
Wow. So a message, any special message?
Well, for that's my message.
People out there.
My message to all Canadians is, thank the Indigenous people. They haven't been wiped out. Canadian policy since contact has been, get rid of those damn people, they're a pain in the ass, we want their land, so we'll do it by trying to make them into copies of us, or cultural genocide, wipe out their culture, their language, and thank God there are still people in Canada that understand their Indigenous roots. So the first thing all Canadians should do is thank them for hanging on to that, and then say, teach us, please. Teach us what you know and what you're fighting for about living with Mother Earth. We need that.
Absolutely. I'm so honored to have met you, Mr. Suzuki.
Thank you for having me.
You know, and just to let you know, our grandson nation is being a lot more closer to the earth now since I met you last.
No.
And I really thank you for that. And thank you so much. Is there anything else you would like to share?
No, it's your interview, not mine.
Yes. So with this, Dr. David Suzuki will be at the Waverly Library this evening. If you have any questions or...
Yeah, it's sold out though.
It is. I hope to see you there. And if not, it'll be recorded, live streamed, and you'll be able to obtain it. I'm so honored that you are here, blessing Thunder Bay again with your presence, and Chimikwich.
Thank you.
So with that, Nijwe Tmo, Kanishinaabe Nakas, Chimikwich, haho.
in 1 second. We've got Dr. Faisal Moola, who's with the David Suzuki Foundation. He's the director for Ontario and Northern Canada. Let's give him a big round of applause. We've got Caitlin Mitchell. She's with EcoJustice, so she's an environmental lawyer. She's fighting the good fight for all of us. Let's give her a big round of applause. We've got Chief Wilfred King from Gull Lake First Nations, not too far from here. Let's give him a big round of applause. And of course, sitting in the middle there is a gentleman who needs no introduction. We've got Dr. David Suzuki. So tonight we're going to be talking about the Blue Dot Movement and about a campaign that we launched in 2014 with a lot of help from Dr. Suzuki and a lot of people in this room that inspired 142 municipalities across Canada to recognize our right to a healthy environment. Towns and cities just But we've launched a campaign empowering our province, Ontario, to recognize a right to a healthy environment. And we're going to talk about that campaign tonight. And it's a tremendous opportunity to protect the people and places that you love, just like the volunteers around this room's t-shirts say. But you know, before we do, I'd like to invite Chief Wilfred King to stand up here, say a few words, and welcome us to the evening.
Bonjour. Kima ogima nijnikaz kia saging donji ogiskemitsi ne do dem. Thank you. Fort William First Nation, and we have members of Fort William First Nation sitting in the front and are here tonight as well. As well, I have also Councillor Kevin King from Gull Bay First Nation, who is in the audience in support of this cause tonight. And we also have two dignitaries that I've noticed, Frank Puglia, who is the acting mayor, and Councillor Paul Pugh as well is also here. So let's give them a round of applause for attending. I had the honor and privilege to meet Dr. Suzuki quite a few years ago, roughly about 25, 30 years ago. He was doing a speech at a gathering in Winnipeg, and I was profoundly impacted by what he had to say in relation to the environment and how First Nations people are very integral to that environment as well. In addition to that, he also spoke at the gala that we had at the community auditorium a few years ago, and it was a full house, and again, I was quite happy to be part of that presentation as well, and we brought a large contingent of our members to that event. And everybody that's here tonight, I think it's really, really important that the environmental movement and First Nations people have many things in common, and that is the protection of the environment, and we need people who will champion our cause like Dr. David Suzuki, and I'm quite honored to see
a little bit of background on the campaign that Blue Dot's running across Ontario. So in 1993, the province of Ontario did something historical. They passed the Ontario Environmental Bill of Rights. And at the time, it was the first law of its kind anywhere in Ontario. It was huge. It was at the forefront of the environmental rights movement. But 20 years later, the bill is showing its age. And just to give you guys a sense, who here remembers the 1993 Toronto Blue Jays? I do. I was about yay tall, taking a break from catching toads, and I was watching these guys win the World Series. It was huge. It was a home run moment for everyone in this province. But who here is seeing the 93 Blue Jays today, 20 years on? They don't look proactively protected from them. Yeah, I've been going to farmers markets, I've been going to festivals across the province, and people, when they hear that, they're shocked. They can't believe it. They thought that these were already recognized rights. So the Blue Dot Movement got organized. We, along with the David Suzuki Foundation and Eco Justice and a number of other organizations, asked the Ontario government to open up the Ontario Environmental Bill of Rights for review and an update. And this province and this government did that. So big round of applause to the government that's opened up for review. And we've gotten organized and launched a campaign across Ontario to call for a right to a healthy environment within that piece of legislation, for a right to breathe fresh air, to drink safe water, to enjoy a stable climate, and to have a say in environmental decisions that impact communities just like this one. And these speakers are going to be talking about how that affects people, not just in the south of the province, but in the north as well, in all regions of this province, because there's a lot of issues here that need to be discussed today. And before I invite Dr. Faisal Moola to come up and say a few words, I'd like to give you guys a few numbers. So since July 12th, when this review began, about 400 Blue Dot volunteers across Ontario have engaged 12,000 Ontarians to submit comments to the Premier and the Minister of the Environment asking for a right to a healthy environment to be included in the Ontario Environmental Bill of Rights. We've got about 50 days left to go, and we want to get that number up to 15 or 20,000 to really show them this popular support across this province. We've met with over a dozen members of parliament, or members of provincial parliament from all three parties, and had tremendous support. And we're really looking forward to a great town hall and to a lot of support from a lot of folks just like you. So without further ado, Dr. Faisal Moola.
Thank you very much. I run the David Suzuki Foundation in Ontario and Northern Canada, but I also work as a scientist at the University of Toronto and at York University. And I think that what's really opportune about this opportunity to have environmental rights enshrined in our policies and our laws is that the scientific data is very, very clear. The planet continues to be used at a rate that is just unsustainable. And so I want to tell you a little bit about a major scientific study that was published just a couple of years ago in the top academic journal in the planet, which is a journal called Science. Now, according to this journal, there are few places on our planet that have not been touched by modern humans. Indeed, satellite images taken from hundreds of kilometers above the planet reveal a world that has been irrevocably changed in a very short period of time. From Arctic tundra to primeval rainforest to arid desert, our natural world has been fragmented by ever-expanding towns and cities, crisscrossed with roads, transmission lines, and pipelines, and pockmarked by pump jacks, flare stacks, and other infrastructure used to drill, frack, and strip mine fossil fuels from the ground. The fact of the matter is that the need to supply food, fiber, and fuel, shelter, and fresh water for more than 7 billion of us that now live on this planet is driving the wholesale conversion of forests, of wetlands, and other ecosystems. For example, researchers have found now that farmland and pasture now rivals natural forest in terms of the amount of land that is covered across the planet. An astonishing 40% of the Earth's land mass is now under the direct influence of humans. And although modern advances in modern agriculture have brought millions of hectares of once unsuitable scrub forest and scrub land into food production, the environmental consequences of our growing food print have been severe in some regions, resulting in the loss of wildlife habitat, degraded water quality, and widespread soil erosion. Now, on the other hand, Canada's rugged and inaccessible terrain, our relatively small and concentrated population, and the relatively recent history of urban and resource development, it has spared us most of the intensity and scale of human land use that is impacting other places like, say, sub-Saharan Africa. A review of the state of Canada's forests by the NGO Global Forest Watch Canada concluded that we are one of the few countries with large tracts of relatively undisturbed woodland left on the planet. They found that about half of Canada's forests are still intact, although they are very threatened by things like logging and fracking and mining and other types of industrial development. Most of the remaining intact nature in the planet is actually found right here in northern Ontario and across the entire country in the boreal forest that sort of covers us like a great green cloak from Newfoundland as far west as the Yukon. Now, one of the largest intact areas of intact nature left on the planet is found in the traditional territories of 9 Oji-Cree First Nations communities in the far north of Ontario. Communities like Nibinomic, Nishkandika, and Webequay, as well as their neighbors. The ancestral lands of these First Nations stretch over thousands and thousands of square kilometers, all the way to the shores of James Bay. These lands are home to threatened species like woodland caribou, and they are dotted with freshwater lakes and rivers and biodiversity-rich wetlands. These indigenous lands have remained more or less unchanged for some 5,000 years, roughly as long as recorded human history. It's the very absence of clear cuts, mines, hydroelectric dams, transmission lines, and other industrial infrastructure, along with the region's rich indigenous landscapes, that makes these lands so exceptional on the planet. And it's for this reason that myself and the David Suzuki Foundation and many of our supporters in the environmental movement believe that we have to support local First Nations as decision makers over their own lands and territories. And we need to do this as they face unprecedented pressures from industrial land use, like mining, for example, in the Ring of Fire. Now, David Suzuki and I just returned from Ontario's far north. We returned from the community of Nibinomic, where they hosted us with such great love and care. The reason we traveled to this relatively isolated indigenous community was to learn firsthand about the importance of the land and water to sustaining indigenous peoples who live there. Roads will impact their rich hunting and fishing grounds. Numerous studies, including studies by my own lab at the University of Toronto, have found that Indigenous communities disproportionately bear the brunt of resource development and the environmental degradation that oftentimes comes along with it, from declining water quality to the I personally believe that we need to have the right to a healthy environment. Earlier this year, David Suzuki and I participated in the Canadian Indigenous Health Conference, which brought together public health experts with Indigenous elders, political leaders, youth, hunters, and trappers. We heard firsthand how many First Nations, Métis, and Inuit communities, and many of the social problems, including alcoholism, depression, and suicide, these are directly linked to the vacuum left when Indigenous across Canada face chronic food insecurity. For example, nearly 70% of Inuit households in Nunavut struggle with getting enough nutrition to stay healthy, compared to 8% for the rest of the country. Now, traditional activities like hunting and fishing are critical to Indigenous food security, but they also support a holistic approach to the overall health and well-being of Indigenous peoples. A report by the David Suzuki Foundation on the importance of caribou hunting to First Nations in Ontario's north found that hunting and fishing practices are not only solely a process of obtaining meat for nutrition. With each hunt, a deliberate set of relationships and protocols are awakened and reinforced. These include reciprocity, social cohesion, spirituality, and passing on of the knowledge to future generations. And yet, these critical values are rarely, if ever, taken into consideration when our governments make decisions that can adversely impact the land and the communities it sustains, such as places like the Ring of Fire. And this is one of the reasons why I personally support changes to Ontario's Bill of Rights, because of my strong belief in a concept called environmental justice. Too often, it's low-income communities and historically disadvantaged groups, especially Indigenous peoples, who are unfairly exposed to and affected by air and water pollution. One only has to look at the community of Grassy Narrows here in northwestern Ontario, where people continue to get sick and die from mercury poisoning while our governments drag their feet and do absolutely nothing. If my experiences working in Indigenous communities have taught me anything, it is that clean air, safe drinking water, and healthy food are the life support systems of our planet. The time has come to bring our political policies and laws in line with these basic natural principles that we must protect the right of a citizen to live in a healthy environment. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Faisal. I'd like to introduce everyone here to Kim Mitchell, or Caitlin Mitchell, not Kim Mitchell. Different. To Caitlin Mitchell from Eco Justice. She's an environmental lawyer, and she's got some wonderful things to say. Come on up, Caitlin.
Good evening. One of the main things that we'll be talking about tonight is the importance of enshrining a right to a healthy environment in Ontario's Environmental Bill of Rights, or EBR. And a right to a healthy environment means a right to an environment that supports life. Things like clean air and water, soil that's free from contamination, and a stable climate. I work at EcoJustice, which is Canada's only national environmental law charity. As lawyers, we refer to rights, like the right to a healthy environment, as a substantive right. The thing that I want to talk to you about tonight is actually the importance of things called procedural rights, and the importance of improving the procedural rights that are currently contained in our EBR. Now, procedural rights may not sound particularly important, but rest assured they are. Procedural rights include things like your right to know about decisions that are made that could significantly impact your local environment, and also your right to have your voice heard when those decisions are made. So, as an illustration of why procedural environmental rights are really important, I want to talk to you about my work in Nova Scotia, which is a province that does not have an EBR, or an Environmental Bill of Rights. So recently, and for the past 3 years or so, I've been working with residents in a community called Harrietsfield. And Harrietsfield is on the outskirts of the Halifax Regional Municipality. And in Harrietsfield, they don't have municipal drinking water, so they rely on well water for drinking. Since the early 2000s, a local construction and demolition recycling facility has caused contamination to the very groundwater that Harrietsfield residents rely on for drinking and other domestic uses like brushing their teeth and doing laundry, washing dishes, things that we tend to take for granted. Before my client Melissa made the very difficult decision to abandon her home and leave the community of Harrietsfield, She drove around with an empty children's bathtub in the trunk of her car so that she could bathe her infant son at the homes of families, of family and friends, because she did not want to expose her son to serious health risks by bathing him in the water from their own taps. And as a mother of a young child myself, I can hardly imagine how stressful that situation must be. So there are a lot of things that I find unjust about the situation that my clients and Harriet Sealed are facing. One of the things that is particularly astounding to me is the extent to which they have been left in the dark about key decisions made in their community. They've been forced to rely largely on freedom of information requests and court proceedings to understand about the contamination that is impacting them daily. They do not have a right to ask their government to investigate violations of their Provincial Environment Act. They do not have a right over the years to be notified about key decisions made about that contaminated site and to be consulted on those decisions. And even this past year, when a ministerial order was issued in relation to that site in order to hold those responsible to account, they found out about it first through the media. So when you leave community members in the dark about decisions that impact their environment and their safety, you can compound the stress for people that are already really concerned about the health of their local environment. Now, fortunately, in Ontario, we actually do have a number of procedural rights already in place. We have the right to be notified about key decisions that are made with respect to the environment, and we have the right to be consulted on those decisions. We have the right to request a review of existing laws or permits where it is necessary to protect the environment. We also have an Environmental Commissioner of Ontario who acts as a sort of environmental watchdog and reports on government compliance with our Environmental Bill of Rights. However, what I want to make clear is that a number of the procedural safeguards in our Environmental Bill of Rights are in serious need of updating. So, for instance, you have the right to be notified about decisions. However, often when you look at those notices, they lack some really key information that's necessary in order for community members to actually understand what the decision means for their daily lives. And you have a right to seek leave to appeal certain decisions, but if you want to appeal a decision about the environment in your community because you think it will have a serious effect, first of all, you have a very, very tough legal test to meet before you're even allowed to proceed with that appeal. And second of all, you've only got 15 days to file all the evidence to prove that you meet that test. And 15 days can sound like a fair amount of time, but let me tell you that when you are working with complex facts and potentially multiple experts, 15 days can go by very quickly, making it nearly impossible to meet that test in a number of circumstances. So what I want to stress is that it's important for us to amend the Environmental Bill of Rights to make sure that our right to a healthy environment is protected, but it's also really important that we improve the existing provisions in the Act to make sure it really is there to achieve its goals. For me personally, one of the reasons that I think environmental rights are so important is that the lack of such rights does not impact us all equally. As Faisal noted, time and time again, it's low-income communities, Indigenous communities, and other historically disadvantaged communities in this country that are left to bear more than their fair share of environmental hazards. And I want to live in an Ontario where, regardless of how much money you make, regardless of your race, regardless of where you live, you have a right to a healthy environment with clean air, clean water, and soil that does not have toxics in it that will make you sick. I also want to live in an Ontario where, regardless of who you are, and regardless of your political connections, you have a right to know about decisions that are going on about your local environment, and you have a right to meaningfully participate in those decisions. So that is the Ontario that I want to live in, and more importantly, that's the Ontario.
Thank you so much, Caitlin. And now I'd like to welcome David Suzuki to the stage.
Traditional territory of the, is it the Fort William First Nations? And, you know, I'm really here to celebrate the fact that Thunder Bay has bought into our idea of the Blue Dot movement. And I want to thank Frank for your acting mayor right now for going to the Federation of Canadian Municipality annual meeting. And there he met with our people and learned about this, brought it back to your council here and got unanimous approval of that. Thank you very much for that. And congratulations to all the citizens of Thunder Bay that you now live in a city that has endorsed this concept. You now join more than 140 communities across Canada that have endorsed this, including the biggest cities in Canada, Vancouver, Montreal, and Toronto. And that's more than one out of every three Canadians now lives in such a jurisdiction. I think it's kind of a grassroots movement. Sounds pretty powerful to me. So thank you all, and thank the people wearing those blue shirts for helping. Why do we need a Blue Dot movement? And we've heard from Eco Justice, we've heard from the David Suzuki Foundation. And let me give you my own personal response to that question. I spent 8 years between 1954 and 1962 studying in the United States, getting an education that wasn't possible at that time in Canada. And I was starting my last year as an undergraduate in college in 1957, and on October 4th, who are the gray hairs in here? Anybody remember October 4th, 1957? Anybody remember what happened? Soviet Union launched Sputnik. I didn't know there was a space program. It was a shock. And the Americans immediately tried to get their rockets into space, and every one of their rockets blew up. And meanwhile, the Russians launched the first animal in space, a dog, Laika. The first man in space, Yuri Gagarin. The first woman in space, Valentina Tereshkova. The first team of cosmonauts. They did the first spacewalk. And we realized, holy cow, the Russians are really advanced. The Americans just threw their money into catching up and passing the Russians. And it was a glorious time to be a student in science. All you had to do, here I was a foreigner living in the States, all you had to do was say, I like science, and they threw money at you. It was glorious. And when I got my PhD, and I didn't even apply for a job, I started getting job offers from Stanford, from the University of California. It was a glorious time. But in 1962, I decided I wanted to go home. I wanted to live in my home, Canada, because Canada was different. Not better, but for me, I preferred Canada. Canada to me meant a country where the CCF, now the NDP, was a legitimate party. Can you imagine the CCF in the States? My God, they would have been called commie pinko whatevers. Tommy Douglas was my great hero. Canada was a country of Medicare, of equalization payments, where the rich provinces shared some of their fortune with the poorer province. Canada meant Quebec. It meant the National Film Board and the CBC. And except for the 8 years of Mr. Harper, I've never regretted coming back to Canada. I returned to Canada in 1962, and I was a hotshot geneticist. And boy, I was going to make my reputation as a scientist, and I got completely sidetracked by a woman. Anyway, happened to me over and over again in my lifetime, but in this case, I'm ever grateful to her. In 1962, just as I was beginning my scientific career, Rachel Carson published a book called Silent Spring. And it was all about the unexpected effects of pesticides. Now here I was, a hotshot scientist, and I began to read this and realize, holy cow, We scientists are clever. We could look at the growth of plants and insects in a Florence flask or a growth chamber or even out in an open controlled field. But we can't see the whole thing. We can't see that when you spray DDT on a farmer's fields to kill insects on that field, you're going to end up affecting fish and birds and human beings. Science is too focused to be able to see the big picture. And I realized as I read her book that we don't know enough to anticipate what the impact of such powerful technology as pesticides would be. It was only when bird watchers, as American farmers began to apply pesticides in huge amounts during the 1950s, by the end of the 1950s, bird watchers began to say something's happening. The birds aren't as abundant, especially raptors like the eagles are disappearing. And biologists tracked it down and discovered something they didn't even know about called biomagnification. You spray at very low concentrations of parts per million. The DDT is absorbed by microorganisms. They're not killed by it. And they concentrate it. And as they're eaten by bigger organisms, at each level up the food chain, you concentrate the DDT. By the time you get to the fatty tissue and the shell glands of birds and the breasts of women, you've concentrated DDT hundreds of thousands of times. It's a process called biomagnification. How could we manage these powerful technologies when we didn't even know there was a phenomenon of biomagnification? And that happens to us over and over again. Before DDT, when atomic bombs were dropped on Japan in 1945, we didn't know there was a thing called radioactive fallout. That was discovered when bombs were tested over Bikini years later. When CFCs began to be used in huge quantities in spray cans, we didn't know CFCs would persist in the environment as they went higher and higher. Ultraviolet light from the sun would break chlorine off the CFCs, and chlorine would scavenge ozone. When scientists began to say CFCs are breaking down the ozone layer, my response was, what ozone? I didn't know there was an ozone layer up there to break down. So over and over again, we find that we can invent powerful technologies, but our knowledge isn't big enough to be able to anticipate what the consequences will be. And of course, that dilemma continues to this day. Scientists are now saying, oh, we know everything about genetics. We're going to engineer organisms to do things for us, and we're going to release wild or salmon out into the wild that will grow twice as fast. We're going to introduce all kinds of plants that are resistant to insects and all of this stuff. And we didn't learn from experience. We don't know enough to anticipate what the consequences will be. But as a result of Rachel Carson's book, then I, like millions of people around the world, was swept up in what we now realize was a modern environmental movement. In British Columbia, we had a very active environmental group, and it was amazing. When her book came out, there wasn't a single department of the environment in any government on the planet. The word environment just didn't mean in 1962 what we now come to understand its meaning today. But as a result of that book, then all kinds of people were mobilized. We began to realize that our technology had consequences. In only 10 years, the first global conference on the environment in 1972 was held in Stockholm. And at that time, the United Nations formally organized UNEP, the United Nations Environment Program, and we saw departments of the environment being set up around the world at all levels of government, from the federal down to the municipal level. And we saw laws enacted to protect air and water and endangered species and millions of hectares of land, because of Rachel Carson, were set aside as parks and as reserves. So huge impact of that environmental movement. And in British Columbia, the kinds of issues I was involved in let us celebrate victories. We, the Americans wanted to take oil from the North Slopes of Alaska. and take oil super tankers through British Columbia waters to refine that oil in Seattle, and we stopped it. There was a big dam that was proposed at Site C on the Peace River, and we stopped that. I got involved after I did a film on the Amazon raising money in Canada to fight a dam being built in Altamira in Brazil, and we stopped it. There was a proposal to drill for oil in Hecate Strait. We stopped that. A proposal to drill for oil in Anwar, the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. We stopped that. So we had many victories that we celebrated as environmentalists. But now, 30, 35 years later, guess what? All of those victories I just talked about are back as fights again. We're fighting exactly the same issues we thought we won 35 years ago. The dam at Site C that we stopped is being built by the BC government. The dam we stopped in Altamira is now in Brazil, is being built at this moment. There's still proposals to drill for oil in Hecate Strait and in the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge. And now it's not American super tankers going along the BC coast. Canadians want, BC wants oil super tankers to be sent out from the end of our pipelines that are going to be built to bring oil from the tar sands to the coast. So I'm saying that despite the enormous changes that have happened since Rachel Carson's time, the reality is environmentalism has fundamentally failed to change the way we see our place on the planet. So if we understood the real lesson coming out of the battles that we thought we'd won, we wouldn't have to fight the same battles over and over again. And that's the challenge that we face now, is to change the way that we see our relationship with the world, because that is what determines the way we treat that world. Many years ago, I went with the anthropologist Wade Davis to a small village on a mountain in the Aru. And I learned there that the children are taught from very young age that the mountain their village is on is an apu. The apu in their language means God. And as long as that apu casts its shadow on that village, it will determine the destiny of everyone in that village. Now imagine how those kids, when they grow up, treat that mountain compared to a kid in Trail, British Columbia in the Rockies, who's taught all their lives, I'll bet those mountains are full of gold and silver. The way we look at the world shapes the way that we treat that world. So if we believe that a forest is a sacred grove, then we won't just treat it as if, oh yeah, well that's lumber and pulp. If a river we see is the circulatory system of the land, then it won't just be an opportunity for irrigation and energy. If we see soil as a complex community of organisms and not just dirt, we'll treat it differently. If another species is our biological kin, our relative, it seems to me we'll treat it with much greater respect than if we simply regard it as a resource. If your house is your home and not just a piece of real estate or property, it seems to me we'll treat it in a different way. So we need to shift the way that we look out at the world and see our place within it. And that has come, the understanding of that need for that shift began when I was called by the Litton Indian Band in the interior of British Columbia. And they said that the British Columbia government has given a logging permit to Fletcher Challenge, a New Zealand forestry company, to log the Stein Valley, which is our valley, and it's sacred. We don't want any trees cut down there by a forest company. Will you come and help us defend it? And so I agreed to try to help them. And at one point, I encountered the CEO of Fletcher Challenge. And I was kind of surprised when I realized, holy cow, this guy is the CEO of the company that wants to cut the forest down. And he was surprised when he realized, holy cow, this is that shit disturber David Suzuki. Started off, oh, hello, how are you? And then very quickly escalated into a shouting match. And finally, in frustration, he said, listen, Suzuki, Are tree huggers like you willing to pay for those trees? If you're not willing to pay money for those trees, they don't have any value till someone cuts them down. And that for me was an epiphany. I realized that in the system that we're operating in, he's absolutely right. You see, he could tell me there are so many board feet of lumber in that forest, so many cubic meters of pulp, so many jobs, and so much profit to be made. And I have to go, well, we could pick some berries every year and maybe cut a few salal bushes for flower arrangement, and maybe we could find a cure for cancer. But as long as I'm having to justify the existence of that forest in economic terms, we'll lose every time. Because the real reason we're fighting for that forest doesn't register in our economic system. First of all, that valley is sacred, sacred to the Lytton people. How do you put a price on something that is sacred? It is beyond economics. It is beyond a dollar and cents estimation. And then, the reason we fight to protect the forest is all of the green things in that forest are taking carbon dioxide out of the air, putting oxygen back in. Not a bad service for an animal like us. If all the green things weren't there, photosynthesizing, guess what? There would be no oxygen in the air. Oxygen is a very reactive element. When oxygen is there, it oxidizes, it rusts. It rusts things. Oxygen is a very reactive element. If it wasn't for plants pumping out oxygen all the time, we wouldn't be able to live. But when you lose the oxygen-making capacity of a forest, you know what economists say? Oh, that's an externality. We don't have to worry about that. It's not a part of our economy. When you think that all of those trees are pumping millions of gallons of water out of the soil, transpiring it into the air and modulating weather and climate, externality, that forest is holding the soil so when it rains, the soil doesn't run into the salmon spawning gravels and spoil the spawning, irrelevant to the economy. And as long as that forest is standing and healthy, it provides habitat for countless other species of animals, of plants, of invertebrates, of insects and microorganisms. All of that, all of the services performed by that forest are irrelevant in our economic system. And so if we continue to raise the economy, I was just asked today by one of the interviewers, well, how do we balance the environment and our need to develop the resources of this area? And I'm going, what the hell are you talking about? The first need is to protect the environment and then ask how can we extract or use our resources without degrading the things that keep us alive. And I realized that we have to shift the discussion. A few, 3 years ago, when I got a phone call from the CEO of one of the largest oil companies in the Alberta tar sands, and he said, could I come and talk to you? I was shocked. I said, great, I'd love to talk to you. I'm not into fighting. I don't think there's any point. Fighting, come on. Next morning, he showed up at my door, and I did the whole, you know, thank you for coming. I'm so honored and thrilled, and this is a great privilege, and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, and I said, thanks for coming. Before you come through the door, I'd like you to do me a favor. Leave your identity as a CEO of an oil company outside. I want you to come in as a human being and meet you as a human being to human being. Because quite frankly, Mr. CEO, I don't want to talk about your company or the emissions or anything until you and I as human beings agree on what are the fundamental needs of all humans on the planet. We must start from a platform of agreement. Then we'll negotiate other things. Well, he wasn't very happy. He had come down as the CEO of an oil company. But to his credit, he reluctantly came into my room and sat down. And I said, look, I realize this is a very awkward thing for you, and so let me tell you where I'm coming from. I said, we live in a world that is shaped by laws of nature. And those laws, they dictate the way that we have to live, and we can't break those laws of nature. We live within them. in physics, we know that you can't build a rocket that will travel faster than the speed of light. Einstein told us that's not possible. And anybody that says we need to build a rocket traveling 100 times the speed of light, you just say, oh, get lost. That's a science fiction idea. We're talking about the world we live in. And we live within that. The law of gravity says you can't build an anti-gravity machine on Earth. And the first and second laws of thermodynamics tell us you cannot build a perpetual motion machine. Those are laws dictated to us by physics. We accept them and we live within their constraints. Chemistry, it's the same. The atomic properties of each of the elements, the diffusion constants and reaction rates are dictated to us by laws of chemistry. And that tells us what atoms that we can put together in a test tube and what kinds of molecules we can synthesize. And we live within those principles that come from chemistry. And in biology, it's the same. In biology, we know that every species has a maximum number that can be sustained indefinitely, and that number is dictated by what's called the carrying capacity of an ecosystem or a habitat. Exceed that carrying capacity, and your population will plunge. While humans are not confined to a habitat or an ecosystem because we're smart, we're able to adapt to very different conditions, but our home is the biosphere, the zone of air, water, and land where all life exists. That's where humans inhabit, and it's finite and fixed, and there is a carrying capacity for our species as well. Of course, it's not just a function of how many humans are there, it's a function as well of how much do we consume per person. But every scientist I've talked to agrees we've already surpassed the carrying capacity of the biosphere for human beings. And you could say, wait a minute, that doesn't make any sense. We're at 7 million, we're going up to 10 million. How can you talk about carrying capacity of humans? The population still growing? Well, we maintain the illusion that everything's all right by using up what is the rightful legacy of our children and grandchildren and all future generations. We're using that up to keep the economy growing and perpetuate the illusion everything's all right. Simply not sustainable. So we are also, biology tells us, we're animals. I gave a speech in Austin, Texas many years ago. There were a lot of kids in the audience, so I said, now kids, if there's one thing you remember from my speech, remember, we are animals. Man, did their parents get pissed off at me? Don't call my daughter an animal, we're human beings. I was so shocked, and I looked at this woman and I said, well, but ma'am, if you're not an animal, are you a plant? We're all animals. And as animals, and this is what I said to the CEO. I said, Mr. CEO, as an animal, what do you think is the most fundamental need every human has? Now, any child would answer right away, but this guy goes, and I could see in his brain he's going, a job, money, a company. I said, look, if you don't take a breath of air for 3 minutes, you're dead. If you have to breathe contaminated air, you're sick. So surely you would agree with me the highest priority of all humans on Earth is to protect clean air. Without it, we've had it. And I said, you and I, Mr. CEO, we're both 60 to 70% water by weight. We're just a big blob of water with enough organic thickener added, we don't dribble away on the floor. But we lose water. It comes out of our skin and our eyes and our mouth. CEO, if you don't have water for 4 to 6 days, you're dead. If you have to drink contaminated water, you're sick. So can we put clean water up there with clean air? And then I said, well, with food, we can go a lot longer. 4 to 6 weeks without food and you're dead. If you have to eat contaminated food, you're sick. And most of our food comes from the soil. So can we put clean food and clean soil up with clean water and clean air? And then finally, I said, every bit of the energy in your body that you and I need to move and grow and reproduce, all of that energy is sunlight. Sunlight captured by plants, converted into chemical energy, and we then get it by eating the plants or the animals that eat the plants. We take that chemical energy and store it in our bodies. And then when we move and we need to do work, we burn those molecules and liberate the energy of the sun back out in our bodies. So can you agree with me? Photosynthesis has got to be up there with clean soil and food, clean water and clean air. And then I said, Mr. CEO, the miracle of life on Earth, to me, is that those four things that indigenous people around the world refer to, the four sacred elements from Mother Earth, earth, air, fire, and water. Those four things are cleansed, replenished, created by the web of living things that scientists call biodiversity on the planet. It's all of the plants in the oceans and on land that are photosynthesizing and creating the oxygen-rich atmosphere. It's all of the soil roots of trees and plants and fungi and microorganisms that filter water as it falls onto the soil. And it's all of the living things that provide us with food. Every bit of our food was once alive. And it's the web of life that creates the very soil on which we grow our food. Anybody that watched the movie The Martian with Matt Damon, you remember he lands and he's suddenly finds he's got to wait 4 years instead of 1 year for to be rescued, and he's only got a year's worth of potatoes. What the hell do you do? Lots of dust and sand and gravel and clay on Mars, but there's no soil. So what did he have to do to grow his potatoes and stretch them out? You poop into each hole to give the plants something to go with. It's life that creates the very soil on which we grow our food. And so when you look at it that way, I said, Mr. CEO, surely you would agree with me that the foundation of the way all human beings must live must surely be to protect clean air, clean water, clean soil and food, clean energy from photosynthesis, and the diversity of living things on the planet. Those are dictated to us, those needs, by the laws of biology. Other things, boundaries that we draw around our property, around our cities, our province, or our country, they don't matter to nature. They're not laws of nature, they're human creations. And we create things like capitalism, the economy, corporations, the market. These aren't forces of nature, they're human inventions. Yet we're constantly saying we've got to squeeze nature to fit our agenda. Those trees don't grow fast enough because we got to cut down more to keep the economy growing. A length of time. We try to shoehorn nature into our agenda, and you can't do that. I was talking to Preston Manning many years ago, and he and I agree on quite a few things, and then I happened to say, the market, and the minute I said the market, his eyes glazed over, and he went, the market, hallelujah, praise the market, free the market, let the market do it. What the hell are you talking about? We invented it. The market isn't a force of nature, but we act as if it is. You know, you read the news, the business page in newspapers, the economy is not looking too healthy. You know, you think the economy is something with a cold bag on its head going, oh man, I feel shitty today. The economy is something we invented. It's not a thing. We reify this concept into a concept that we think is real. If our economy, if our markets aren't working, we can fix them. We can change them. We can't change the laws of nature. And so what I think the challenge we face now is with environmental, with new legislation, what we have to do is recognize that the very basis on which we exist, our lives, our well-being and health, depend on Mother Nature. And we can't change that. And so whatever we do has got to be built on the understanding we've got to, above everything else, ensure that those things that keep us alive and healthy are protected before anything else. And I think even in the conversation about a constitutional amendment, just in the in the discussion about it, we begin to learn that there is another way of looking at the problems. And I must say that everything I've said, I have learned from Indigenous people, not just in Canada, but around the world. They have taught me that perspective, so it's not a surprise. When we did our cross-Canada tour 2 years ago, went from Newfoundland to Vancouver over 7 weeks in a bus, that it was in every community, it was the First Nations that gathered with us and said, we want to be part of this because this is what we've always wanted. We've wanted the protection of these. They understand the core of their being, that this is a part of who they are, and they have stood with us. So when we started the campaign, I said, this is not just for environmentalists or biologists or even First Nations. This has got to be a big tent. And so it was. We made sure that we included a broad range. Robert Bateman, one of Canada's eminent artists, joined us. Margaret Atwood joined us and read a composition that she had composed. Shane Coyson, a poet, one of the great poets of our time, came with us and read in many of our communities. And we had people like Bruce Coburn and Gordon Lightfoot and Neil Young and Joel Plaskett. The list of musicians was very impressive. And the National Ballet joined us in Winnipeg, composed an original piece that they performed for us. This is about all of us. And when we started the tour, I said, gee, you know, I don't think I'll live to see it happen, but we can give it a big kickoff. Now I'm thinking it's doable within my lifetime. So thank you all for being a very early part of what I think is going to be a massive movement across the country. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, David Suzuki. Now, before we wrap up tonight, a few local environmental organizations passed along a few questions that they wanted to ask our panel of experts. I think we've got time for one or two of those questions tonight. So, the first question that we have comes from Brad Duff, who's with the Earth Care Thunder Bay. And before I read the question, I'd like to mention a few things about the great work that's happening here in the city of Thunder Bay. So in January, the city approved its climate adaptation strategy, which has gained recognition across North America and across Ontario. And you can read about the strategy at climatereadycity.com. And Thunder Bay has done Thunder Bay has done some incredible work around low-impact development, around green infrastructure projects, and promoting sustainable development and active transportation. So this question, I think I'd like to first begin by directing it to Caitlin and then broaden it to any of the other incredible people we've got assembled here today. So Brad asks, as a municipal employee, but also a citizen, he would like to know how a stronger environmental bill of rights in Ontario would allow municipalities like Thunder Bay to become more sustainable. Does it give municipalities more teeth and a stronger mandate to protect the environment? Caitlin?
So the first point that I would make in answering that question is that it's important to keep in mind that the Environmental Bill of Rights is a provincial statute, so it applies across the province. But what I would say is that enacting, for instance, a right to a healthy environment within the Environmental Bill of Rights could certainly improve sustainability. And certainly that's been the experience internationally. Studies have shown that in countries where they've recognized their citizens' right to a healthy environment, they perform better environmentally, but also better economically. So certainly, I think that a strong and updated Environmental Bill of Rights that contains a right to a healthy environment, but also some really key environmental law principles that are currently missing, like the precautionary principle, the principle of intergenerational equity, for instance, that a strong EBR that's updated could go a long way to improving sustainability across the province. And one tool that's also in the Environmental Bill of Rights that we haven't talked about tonight is something called an SEV, or a Statement of Environmental Values. And what that means is whenever a provincial agency or decision maker makes an environmentally significant decision, they have a mandate to actually consider the principles of the Environmental Bill of Rights. And although that's not required municipally through the EBR, I think that would be a very interesting thing to see if municipalities were to adopt a similar approach and require decisions be made consistent with really key environmental law principles.
So Corgan, implicit in that question is, well, you know, if we enact this legislation, what are your solutions to, you know, protecting the business and all that? That's the implication, that we can't pass this if we don't know where it's going to lead us, which is always, it's a mistake to get into that. I raised the issue of Sputnik. When John F. Kennedy in 1961, they were still very far behind the Russians, said, we're going to get a person to the moon and back within a decade. We had no idea how they were going to do it. He just made the commitment and then poured the personnel and resources and money into doing it. And look at what happened. Not only are they the only country to land people on the moon, but they were the first and only country. But all of the unexpected benefits that resulted from just making the commitment. Every year, NASA publishes a magazine called Spinoff, and it lists hundreds of things that resulted from the commitment to go into space. Nobody knew there would be cochlear implants, that there would be ear thermometers, space blankets, GPS, laptops, 24-hour news channels. I mean, there are hundreds of things that resulted, but the only commitment was, we're going to get to the moon first. And I say that's what we've got to do in terms of the challenge. The environment, the clean, a healthy environment is everything for our survival. This isn't a choice between whether to do this or not because of the economic implications. This is a commitment we make, and then we find all kinds of opportunities to ensure that we can live while protecting those values. And I am sure, I guarantee you, I won't be around to live up to that guarantee, but I guarantee you, there will be all kinds of unexpected things that will happen, and then you'll go, oh my God, why didn't we make that decision sooner?
Would anybody else like to take a stab at the question? So the next question that we have comes from Peter Lang of Citizens United for a Sustainable Planet. And I'm going to direct this question to David first. Thunder Bay City Council voted for the right to a healthy environment, which is a Blue Dot declaration that they passed in 2015. Citizens for a Sustainable Planet asked them to publicly oppose the proposed energy's pipeline on the basis of unacceptable risk of a catastrophic spill and the huge threat posed by massive new fossil fuel infrastructure to the climate. As an organization, they think that voting for the right to a healthy environment commits council to oppose the pipeline. David, and to the rest of the panelists, do you see a link between the recognition of environmental rights and the opposition of projects like Energy East?
What can I say? Of course. But I approach it from a different point of view. Our government, thank goodness, it's no longer a Harper government. Our government did something very, very remarkable. They were elected in October. Within 2 months, they went off to Paris. And they not only agreed, they set a very high bar that we would keep from lifting the temperature above 2 degrees this century, but preferably closer to 1.5. That's a very high bar because it's already 1 degree warmer than pre-industrial time. So we don't have much space for another half degree rise. Canada committed to that. Well, what does that mean? If we're serious about that target, we know exactly how much carbon can be released into the atmosphere. And what that means is that we must leave 80 to 85% of the oil in the ground. The known reserves of oil and coal have to be left there. So what the hell are we talking about pipelines for? If we invest in billions of dollars in pipelines, in order to recover that money, you have to use it for 30 years or more. We have to be off fossil fuels long before that. So there shouldn't be any discussion on pipelines. And this is what I wrote to Trudeau. I said, are you committed to 1.5 or not? And if you are, why are we even talking about pipelines? Why are we talking about expanding railways or building new coal terminals? Those are off the agenda. We shouldn't be subsidizing the fossil fuel industry. We shouldn't be doing any more exploration for fossil fuels because we've got too much that we know about. And the first thing you do is begin to shut down the extreme areas where we're getting energy now, and that is the tar sands out in the ocean and fracking and shale. They've got to be shut down. Shut down right away. And so
would anybody else like to take a chance on that question? And so the final question came to us this afternoon from a Blue Dot volunteer in Southern Ontario who couldn't be here tonight because of the geographic distance. And that volunteer has heard about the issues in Grassy Narrows First Nations with mercury in the river. And she wanted to know, what impact would a strengthened Ontario Environmental Bill of Rights have on people in communities like Grassy Narrows or in Sarnia's Chemical Valley? I'd like Faisal to take a stab at this first.
Well, thank you very much. It's absolutely inconceivable to me that the provincial and federal government allows for the crisis in Grassy Narrows to continue and in First Nations and Indigenous communities across this country, hundreds of communities that do not have access to something that we all take so much for granted, which is access to clean water. So first, I would like to say that we could clean up the situation in Grassy Narrows immediately. We don't actually need to wait for new legislation like the right to a healthy environment. Many of my colleagues who are experts in water quality have written to the Premier and have said that it is possible to clean up the rivers and lakes in Grassy Narrows. It is possible to make the fish safe again to eat, but it will only happen with political will. And the sad situation is that that political will is absolutely lacking right now. And people continue to get sick and people continue to get to die because of that. So I would say, first of all, we need to take the tools that we have available to us now to bring clean water to Indigenous territories across this country. We don't actually need to bring new policies or laws like the right to a healthy environment. But that said, the right to a healthy environment is critical because it allows us to proactively act to ensure that no other community is ever faced with the horror and the chaos that Indigenous communities have faced, like Grassy Narrows. It is unbelievable to me that the people of Grassy Narrows had to file Freedom of Information requests to find out that their own children are actually have mercury poison in their blood at a level that is making them sick. The right to a healthy environment would ensure that people have that information on a regular basis. But much more importantly, the right to a healthy environment would ensure that a community could go to government and be empowered to go to government to ensure that their water is clean and safe to drink and bathe and to cook with. Thank you.
Yeah, so I couldn't agree more with what Faisal said. The only two points that I would add are, when it comes to a right to a healthy environment, one of the really interesting things that we've seen internationally is that once a right to a healthy environment is recognized, often courts will also recognize the principle of non-aggression, which basically means you can't go back on environmental laws. You can't lower environmental law standards. We have a baseline and we move forward from that baseline. So a right to a healthy environment could be really important to communities like Omgenong, which is in Chemical Valley, or Grassy Narrows, because it would mean that new environmental laws would have to be better than the old ones, but also that new laws couldn't be such that they violate your fundamental right to a healthy environment, and new decisions wouldn't be able to violate that right. And right now, unfortunately, I know all too well in Omgenong, because I've also worked with clients in that community, government decisions don't consider things like cumulative effects. They ignore the fact that there are 60 major facilities around that one community. And decision making at one of those facilities may look insignificant, but when you consider the context, it's significant. We're talking about serious health risks. So what I do a lot of the time is actually go to court. And on that point, I would also just like to say that in addition to law reform, which we're talking about tonight, which is really, really fundamentally important, around the world, there's over 110 countries that recognize their citizens' right to live in a healthy environment. And in a lot of those countries, the way they got there was actually through litigation and through the courts. That is, the courts recognize that their existing rights to things like life, security of the person, that those existing rights encompass a right to a healthy environment. And I think that there's some room to do that in Canada as well, to say that our charter right under Section 7 that guarantees our right to life, liberty, and security of the person encompasses also some aspects of a right to a healthy environment, and surely means that government can't lawfully make decisions that put our health at risk by putting toxics into our environment and into our bodies. And that's particularly important in communities like Grassy Narrows and Omgenong First Nation. Thanks.
First of all, I'd like to thank the question. I think the question is very, very important. I was saddened to hear the fact that we have now second and third generation children impacted by mercury poisoning in Grassy Narrows. I come from Lake Nipigon, which is considered probably one of the freshest water in Canada to this day. But there is still contamination, and we get contamination also from methyl mercury as a result of the flooding of the Goki Reservoir, which flows down the Little Jackfish River into Lake Nipigon. So we're also impacted by mercury contamination as well. But I think that what's really important, I think the it hasn't been addressed as of yet tonight, and I feel it's my duty to make some comments on not only just environmental protection law, but also on Aboriginal and treaty rights. I think it's so important for Canadians to recognize that when you protect Aboriginal and treaty rights, you also protect environmental rights. There is a direct connection between the two. We also have the right under the United Nations Charter on the rights of Indigenous people, the right of free and prior informed consent. And that is something that has to be enshrined in our Constitution. I know that Minister Raybould said that they cannot enact upon that because they feel it's too broad. But I think it's really important that when Aboriginal people win, whether it's a treaty right case or an Aboriginal right case, it's a case that we all win, because it's embedded in that right is the protection of the environment. So without further delay, I think it's important that Canadians must embrace Aboriginal, First Nation, and treaty rights. Chimigwech.
Well, I just wanted to mention, thank you, Chief, for your comments. I think that they are so, so apt right now. And I'll have to say, just speaking on behalf of the David Suzuki Foundation, one of the reasons why I have worked for David for 15 years, and I'm so proud to work for this environmental organization, is because our organization has always worked with the goal of advancing Indigenous rights, advancing treaty rights in the protection of the environment. We have passed an Aboriginal People's Policy which mandates that all of our work is done consistent with the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. And that is absolutely true. And I think that this concept of free, prior, and informed consent is absolutely critical. Because one of the things I've learned as an ecologist working very closely with lawyers like Caitlin is the fact that these indigenous and treaty rights are inherently predicated, as the chief has said, on a healthy environment. The rights that indigenous peoples have to hunt, to fish, to gather berries, to live their lives as they had lived for thousands of years before colonization is inherently predicated on the ability of the land to continue to produce fish and meat and berries and all the things that have sustained their communities for thousands of years. Those rights are effectively meaningless if the environment is degraded or destroyed. And we have obligations as settlers, and I have obligation as an immigrant, a recent immigrant to this country, to ensure that those treaty and indigenous rights are protected, because the treaty goes both ways. So I think that another thing that we have to do in taking away from this event is we not only have to enshrine the right to a healthy environment, we have to do everything in our power to support our treaty and indigenous rights of First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people in this country. Thank you.
So before we conclude the evening, I'd like to give a warm round of hand to warm, I can't speak tonight, I'm very sorry. a warm applause to all of our fabulous speakers. Let's hear it for Faisal Moola. Let's hear it for Chief King. Let's hear it for Caitlin Mitchell. And ladies and gentlemen, a very warm round of applause for Dr. David Suzuki for coming out here tonight. Now, everyone should have noticed that when you came in, there was a postcard on your seat. That postcard is part of our campaign to ask the province of Ontario to recognize the right to a healthy environment in the Ontario Environmental Bill of Rights. I'd ask that everyone in this room takes a moment before you leave here today to write a quick message. We're going to present these cards to Premier Wynne, to Minister Glenn Murray, and we're going to email a digital copy to each and every one of your local MPPs. So it's a really powerful way of making your voice heard as part of this great process. And I'd also like to invite everyone to stay for a few minutes afterwards. We don't have as much time as we'd hoped because we ran a little bit longer than anticipated, to have a quick reception, to meet some of our fantastic volunteers, and to learn more about how you can become involved in this grassroots movement that's taking place from coast to coast to coast in communities from of every size, every scale, and every makeup in this country. And I'd also like to thank everyone for coming out, and please visit www.blue.ca. Thank you so much, and have a wonderful evening.